North Dallas 40 has action. Romance.
We got the blood up now.
Oh, yeah.
It's an old story. Boy meets boy.
Well, I love happy endings.
Excitement.
They're shooting cows.
And wait till you see the weird part.
Weird part?
Yeah, it gets weird.
It's got everything that makes the cheerleaders cheer. North Dallas 40, rated R.
Starts Friday at the Cottonwood Mall and the Elk Cinema.
Share the good times, you know things are going right. And when you're hot and thirsty, you know it's time for Sprite. And you know Lyman is the secret of Sprite. Lyman is the secret of Sprite.
Sprite takes the cool taste of limes and lemons to give your thirst the refreshing taste of Lyman.
And you know Lyman is the secret of Sprite. Lyman is the secret of Sprite.
Hello, Utah.
This court therefore agrees and concurs with the advisory sentence in the recommendation entered by the trial jury.
I think I stand about as much chance of dying in front of a firing squad or in a gas chamber as you do being killed in a plane flight home.
It is therefore the sentence of this court, count two of the indictment, you, Theodore Robert Bundy, be adjudicated guilty of murder in the first degree, and that you be sentenced to death for the murder of Margaret Bowman.
Mr. Bundy?
He told me that you told him there you were going to get me. He said he was going to get me, okay? You've got the indictment. It's all you're going to get.
As to count three of the indictment, you, Theodore Robert Bundy, be adjudicated guilty of murder in the first degree, and that you be sentenced to death for the murder of Lisa Levy.
Contrary to Section 78204 Florida statute.
I'll plead not guilty right now.
It is further ordered that on such scheduled date that you be put to death by a current of electricity sufficient to cause your immediate death, and such current of electricity shall continue to pass through your body until you are dead.
Theodore Robert Bundy, at age 25, a Republican campaign worker in Seattle. At 28, a University of Utah law student. At 29, a convicted Utah kidnapper. At 30, a Colorado jail escapee and one of the FBI's 10 most wanted men. Today at age 32, Theodore Robert Bundy stood in a Florida courtroom and listened to a judge describe his pending death in the Florida electric chair. That must have been a terrifying moment for this young man who has maintained his innocence in every crime he has been accused of. Yet Ted Bundy showed no visible sign of emotion. For more than 3 weeks, the Florida judicial system has struggled with the question of Bundy's guilt or innocence in the murders of two Florida State University sorority sisters. A crime so brutal, it made national headlines before it was ever discovered that Ted Bundy was involved. Last week, the jury said Bundy was guilty. Yesterday, the same jury said Bundy should die for the crime. Today, Judge Edward Coward agreed. NewsWatch 2 reporters Larry Warren and Allison Heyrin have been covering the trial from Florida since jury selection began in Tallahassee. Larry Warren is standing by live right now in Miami where the trial ended. And Larry, this isn't the last we'll hear of this case, though, is it?
No. Terry, Ted Bundy's case is not closed by any stretch of the imagination. All death sentences in Florida are automatically appealed to the state Supreme Court, and there are avenues of appeal beyond that. Both Bundy and his defense lawyers have said they think there are good, strong grounds for appeal. Bundy's hope is that he will get a new trial, one in which he can be cleared of the murders he says he did not commit. The murders he was sentenced to death for today were committed a year and a half ago. The formal charges came down last July.
Gentlemen, I'm not going to be paraded the empty cars today.
Step out, Mr. Bundy.
What do we have here, Ken? Let's see. Oh, it's an indictment, all right. Why don't you read it to me? You're about for election, aren't you?
Mr. Bundy?
You got it, didn't you?
Mr. Bundy?
He told me that you told him there you were going to get me. He said he was going to get me, okay? You've got the indictment. It's all you're going to get. Let's read it. Let's go.
Theodore Robert Bundy, you are charged, indictment, two counts burglary in the, two counts murder in the first degree, three counts attempted murder in the first degree.
The legal road to the electric chair began here, in the Leon County Jail, a year and a week ago.
in a bizarre confrontation between a sheriff with an eye toward re-election and his celebrity prisoner Ted Bundy, fresh off the FBI's 10 most wanted list. The television camera was there to record the start of the case of the state of Florida versus Theodore Robert Bundy. It would remain focused on him to the end.
My chance to talk to the press.
Contrary to section 78204 Florida statute.
I'll plead not guilty right now.
And from the handful of reporters covering his initial Florida arrest in Pensacola, the media focus would grow. Ted Bundy moved from a Salt Lake to a regional to a national crime figure. By the time his trial ended in Miami, reporters and cameramen for networks, newspapers, and TV stations coast to coast were jockeying for camera position. Ted Bundy had become a national figure, a convicted double murderer, a suspect in perhaps dozens more killings around the West. Newspaper copy described him as perhaps the most prolific killer of young women in the history of the nation. The crime that launched him to national attention was in Tallahassee, the campus of Florida State University, the state capital, a white-collar city of 85,000 in northern Florida's panhandle. Mid-January 1978, the Chi Omega sorority house. In the early morning hours, through a back door, the intruder came in carrying an oak tree limb. Most Chios had come back from their dates and gone to bed. That's where the intruder found Margaret Bowman, asleep. She never woke up. She died in her bed, beaten, strangled, sexually molested. Further down the hall, Lisa Levy was asleep. She, too, died without regaining consciousness. At autopsy, the medical examiner noted, measured, and photographed a double bite mark on her body. Still further down the hall, roommates Karen Chandler and Kathy Kleinert survived their attacks. Both were asleep. Neither woke up till they were in the hospital. Neither saw their attacker. Nita Neary did. Her date lasted longer than most. At 3:25 a.m., she closed the back door the intruder opened. She heard a thump upstairs. She heard footsteps. She walked into the front lobby in time to glimpse the attacker from the side, running out the front door. A stocking cap pulled low, a club in his hand. An hour later, a few blocks away on Dunwoody Street, another attack had begun. Cheryl Thomas, asleep in her half of the duplex, was beaten with a board. She survived, remembering nothing of the attack. A network TV movie about a sorority house killer was canceled. Tallahassee was in shock. A month later, Ted Bundy was in jail in Pensacola, 200 miles down the road. A half year later, the sheriff read him the charges, and a year-long legal process had begun. By spring, Bundy, the aspiring lawyer, was in this Tallahassee courtroom, arguing pretrial motions before Judge Edward Cowart.
I have trouble articulating to the court constant and, what you might call it, the omnipresent distractions that have imposed to Mr. Minerva, Mr. Harvey, Mr. Thomas, and myself, and considering how we're going to conduct these hearings in front of the eye of the camera.
The camera, Cowart said, would stay.
We're conducting the public's business, gentlemen, and we're going to conduct it in the sunshine, as we've said in Florida.
The bite marks on Lisa Levy, forensic dentist Richard Souveron said, were like fingerprints and pointed to Ted Bundy's mouth as the source. Bundy said dental impressions of him were obtained illegally. Wrong, Judge Cowart said. It was legal. He would admit the testimony. I want a new attorney, Bundy said. Chief Tallahassee Public Defender Michael Minerva had been on the case since the start, but Bundy wanted him fired.
My counsel have communicated to me, one, a belief that they cannot win this case, and two, a belief in the case of Mr. Minerva that I will receive a defense from counsel who believes in my guilt.
June, Vordire, jury selection, Tallahassee. Citizens here had not forgotten that January night. Too many knew too much.
I'm satisfied concerning this jury. Ladies and gentlemen, I am going to grant a motion for change of venue based upon what we've seen this afternoon, and you may instruct the jurors, Mr. Bailiff. We will begin jury selection in Miami on the morning of June 25th.
Miami, 500 miles south and east. The Chi Omega case had made the news, but there were murders of more interest here. Drug murders in a city known as the drug capital of the nation, an entry point for South American smugglers. It's where Bundy wanted his case heard by a panel of his peers.
Swear the jury, Madam Clerk.
Stand your right hand, please.
All jurors, please stand. Raise your right hand.
While waiting for the verdict a month later, Bundy thought the jury selection was a victory.
The critical moments in the courtroom began, of course, with jury selection, where I think we won hands down. We got a superb jury, all things considered.
With a jury sequestered in a beachfront resort, the judge heard more Bundy motions. Nita Neary's eyewitness identification was unreliable, his new lawyer Robert Haggard argued. Haggard had replaced Michael Minerva, who withdrew from the case in Tallahassee. The judge said the jury could decide for itself how reliable she was. But with Neary's and Dr. Suvaron's testimony ruled admissible, the prosecution team was still nervous. It was not a strong murder case. Nita Neary was coming home late from a party. She glimpsed a brief profile in a darkened hallway. The bite marks would be attacked by defense dental experts. The whole field of forensic dentistry was so new, few courts were even allowing it. There was circumstantial evidence, Bundy living near the Chi Omega house, Bundy living under an assumed name, Bundy dancing at the disco next door to Chi Omega the night of the murders. But they needed more, and that was in Utah. They wanted the jury to hear that Utah detectives found a pantyhose mask when Bundy's car was stopped early one morning on a Granger, Utah street years earlier. At Cheryl Thomas's Dunwoody Street duplex, investigators found such a pantyhose mask, and Margaret Bowman was strangled with pantyhose. A victory for Bundy. Judge Cowart said Utah evidence would not be shown to the jury. After a week of sequestration, the jury heard the case prosecutors were nervous about. They saw Nita Neary identify Bundy.
Do you recall the man that you saw at the door of the Chi Omega house on the morning of January 15, 1978?
Yes, I do.
Okay. And is that man in the courtroom today?
Yes, he is.
Would you point him out for us, please? Describe his clothing for us, please.
The dark pinstripe suit with the red tie.
Let the record reflect that she has identified the
They heard Dr. Suvaron's analysis of the bite marks.
Can you tell us within a reasonable degree of dental certainty if those teeth made the marks on those photographs?
Yes, sir.
And what is that opinion, sir?
They made the marks.
They heard a parade of witnesses fill in circumstantial evidence. Suspicious Bundy behavior patterns were emerging. The defense worked to blunt the testimony, but by the final day of testimony, Bundy knew a weak case had only become stronger. He had complained from the beginning that his young Tallahassee defense team was unprepared. He'd wanted a larger role for himself all along. By the final Saturday, Haggard walked out.
And then there were three.
Another public defender wanted out.
Man's life is on the line. It's at stake. He should not be forced to take the services of court-appointed lawyers, public lawyers, who does not have confidence in.
Robert Haggard was going to give the closing statement. Now, on short notice, that job fell to Margaret Good. Her first murder case was the most notorious murder case in Florida.
If there are any doubts that sounds reasonable to you, then my client, Ted Bundy, must be acquitted.
Good's close was sandwiched between prosecutor Larry Simpson's closing argument.
Ladies and gentlemen, how many people in this world could have hair exactly like Theodore Bundy?
And then the jury retired. They sent out one request Monday night, a transcript of testimony about the pantyhose mask found at Cheryl Thomas's duplex. Judge Cowart, throughout the trial, had combined stern, thoughtful decision-making with folksy humor. While awaiting the transcript, there was time for humor.
Larry, I had a jury out one time. It was on a first-degree murder case. One of the funniest juries I think I'd ever seen. There was one little girl on there. Just ate all the time. And we waited until the sandwiches got there and we gave them to them, and then we took the verdict and we told them, I said, now you've got your sandwiches, go ahead and complete it. And all of them left but about two, and of course she was one, and every one of the sandwiches were gone. I think she ate 10 of them. I never seen anything like it in my life. Oh, she was an eating lady.
With the transcript delivered, the jury took little time finalizing its decision, and Judge Cowart's demeanor changed for the formal reading of the verdict.
Count three of the information, a jury of your peers having found you guilty of murder in the first degree upon Lisa Levy, this court adjudges you guilty.
Cameramen scrambled for elbow room, and five floors above in a makeshift press room, the scramble was on to beam the news by satellite across Florida and west to Seattle, Salt Lake City, and Denver.
We'll get on as quickly as possible. There is no satellite time at the moment. We do not know.
Now it is time for appeal, perhaps a year or more before the case is closed.
Well, the direct appeal itself will take quite a good amount of time just in getting the record together, because it's an enormous amount of paper that's going to be pushed around. And even once it's heard, then the decision's going to take a long time, because the judge is going to have to read all that paper.
And there is yet another case titled The State of Florida versus Theodore Robert Bundy. February 1978, Columbia County, Florida. The search was on near the fabled Suwannee River for 12-year-old Kimberly Ann Leach. 3 weeks after the Chi Omega killings, she disappeared with no trace. 8 weeks of searching led to her body in an abandoned tin shack next to an empty hog pen. Plans move forward to try Ted Bundy for the Leach murder in September, but Bundy defender Ed Harvey sees no way now to find any potential juror who has not heard of Theodore Robert Bundy.
I don't see how that Ted can get an impartial jury anywhere in the state of Florida at this point.
The TV center here in Miami is now virtually deserted. Most everyone has packed up or is in the process of packing up to return home to Denver, Seattle, Salt Lake City, and cities throughout Florida. The reason this case was so heavily covered is because this was not Theodore Bundy's first criminal offense. He is a convicted kidnapper in Utah. He is accused of murder in the state of Colorado, and he is a leading suspect in other Utah murder cases. Back now to Salt Lake City for more on Ted Bundy's past.
That's right, Larry. Last Tuesday's verdict shuts the case, at least for now, in the Chi Omega murders. But here in the West, there are still unanswered questions in a number of murder cases. After Ted Bundy was convicted last week in Florida, Salt Lake County Sheriff Peter Hayward said Ted Bundy was a prime suspect in some of those murders. The unsolved crimes frustrate police, but they are even more frustrating for the families of those murder victims. Michael Rawson has more on some of those families. Mike?
Patrick, it now seems unlikely that Ted Bundy will ever leave Florida, and unlikely also that law enforcement officials will ever know for sure if he is the mass murderer they've accused him of being. And families of victims will never have those nagging questions answered.
Deborah Kent and Melissa Smith, both 17, they disappeared within 3 weeks of each other in the fall of 1974. Some evidence pointed to Theodore Bundy.
You believe Ted Bundy killed your daughter?
I do. I believe that with all my heart. I feel it. And I really think he's a psychopath, and I think that he will murder another girl, and I think the death rattle is a deterrent, and I'm very pleased that the jury had enough guts to recommend it.
Melissa left her father on the night of October 18, 1974, to meet a friend at this Midvale restaurant. They talked for a while, and then Melissa left, she said, for home, but she never got there. 9 days later, Melissa's body was found in Summit County. She had been beaten and strangled with a nylon stocking.
Melissa Smith was buried in the Midvale Cemetery. Ted Bundy would become a suspect a year later when microscopic strands similar to her hair were found in his car.
I want to know that the young girls are safe on the street. I don't want another parent to go through what my wife and I went through. I don't think that's right. That isn't justice. As far as the revenge, she's gone. It doesn't matter. I mean, I know I'll see her again within my own religious beliefs.
There is no peace for Debbie Kent's family.
Totally
her body has never been found. Belva Kent has become a Bundy expert of sorts, reading everything about him she can. At his kidnapping trial, Mrs. Kent followed him during court recesses and watched him at lunch. There was a question she never got to ask.
I wanted to talk to him, and the police asked me not to. After the trial was over and he was convicted, they asked me not to. I only wanted to say a couple of words, and they...
What were you going to say?
I just wanted to say, where's Deb's body?
Debbie was attending a play with her family at Viewmont High School on the night of November 8, 1974. She left the play early to pick up her brother at an ice rink. Debbie never got to her car. Although her body was never found, Ted Bundy became a suspect. A teacher and some students selected Bundy's picture as the man they saw hanging around the school during the play.
And then there was the handcuff key found here in the Viewmont High parking lot. Police believe the key was from the same handcuffs Ted Bundy used to kidnap Carol DeRoche. 4 hours earlier, the same night, Debbie Kent disappeared.
If he's brutally murdering all these people, why should he go on living when everyone else has lost their daughters? I mean, that doesn't bring them back, true. And it probably doesn't give you a lot of peace of mind or satisfaction, but at least you know he's gone and someone else isn't going to lose their daughter.
The hardest part of the past 5 years, Mrs. Kent says, is the heartache of not knowing.
Even though after this long and with all the evidence and everything we know what's happened, yet in the back of your mind you don't want to believe that. You keep kidding yourself and thinking maybe, but even though without a doubt you know that it's gone. And if you had her body, you'd know it would all be over. The peace of mind would be there. You could bury the body, you could say, here she is, and that would be it.
Nighttime at the Kent's home in Bountiful. His front porch light burns for Debbie. It's been on night and day for 5 years. Mrs. Kent vowed when her daughter disappeared, I'll turn the light off only when Debbie comes home. Michael Ross, News Watch 2, Bountiful.
Ted Bundy has never been charged with the Melissa Smith or Deborah Kent murders. But from jail in another state, he talked about those investigations, which would continue in Utah.
I know that it's a long time ago, it ceased to be an issue as whether or not I was innocent or guilty. The issue is now is, can we pin it on him? Can we follow through and maintain our reputation as law enforcement officers? And I'll tell you, as long as they attempt to keep their heads in the sand about me, there's going to be people turning up in canyons, and there are going to be people being shot in Salt Lake City because the police there aren't willing to accept what I think they know, and they know that I didn't do these things.
Ted Bundy said that 2 years ago in his Colorado jail cell to KUTV reporters Barbara Grossman and Lucky Severson. He was awaiting trial for the murder of Karen Campbell, a young Michigan nurse. Bundy became the prime suspect after he was convicted of trying to kidnap Carol DeRoche in March 1976. When he was arrested, police found a brown gym bag in his car containing this evidence, a ski mask, an ice pick, some strips of torn sheet. Later, the FBI crime lab confirmed these hair samples matched those of murder victim Melissa Smith and Carol DeRoche. Is there any doubt in your mind that Ted Bundy was guilty of that attempted kidnapping?
No doubt whatsoever.
When you tell me the circumstantial evidence, I'm not going to argue with you, Lucky. It's just, let's just wait and let's just let it come out in court. Let's let it be examined in open court, and I'll lay my money on me.
Before the Colorado charges came out in open court, Ted Bundy escaped. During a break in a court hearing, he leaped from the second-story window. He was free a week before police recaptured him driving a stolen car.
I've matured in the past year. Believe me, I've grown in the past year, and I've learned a lot of things about myself in the past year. Being in prison, going through a kind of hell, matures a person, and I think it's done good things for me. My only misgivings is that I might never be in a position to apply it, you know, on the streets where I'd like to apply it.
On New Year's Eve 1977, Bundy, starved down to less than 140 pounds, slipped through a hole in the ceiling of his cell and was free again. The next time he would go to jail would be in Pensacola, Florida. Authorities there arrested him February 15, 1978, as he drove down the northern Florida highway in a stolen car. They didn't know who Ted Bundy was, he would recall later. I told the officer who arrested me he should make sergeant.
It didn't take Tallahassee police long to learn his identity, however. Several months later, they charged him with murdering two Florida State University co-eds. And Patrick, as we've seen with the help of a camera in the courtroom and our satellite feeds, he was convicted there.
That's right, Allison. One thing that all of us here have been talking about for weeks of this whole trial is it is a very unusual trial, not only because the case itself and because it started, the Ted Bundy saga sort of started in Utah and now has ended up in Florida. Really, the one dominant impression, at least that I have, sitting here and watching it every night, and is the camera in the courtroom. It was just fascinating to see our judicial process in action, so to speak, and actually see the testimony presented, the jury selected, Ted Bundy, the verdict being read, and also the sentence being read today of Edward Cowart. And at the risk of sounding somewhat self-serving, we really feel that this was a great exercise in showing what a camera can do in the courtroom, and that all of us have that right to know and to be inside a courtroom to see what actually happens during our judicial proceedings. And Larry Warren has been spent about the last month and a half in Florida, in Tallahassee and Miami. And Larry, what impressions do you have? You've spent a lot of time there on the ninth floor. And
a lot of time in the courtroom, Patrick. One thing that was fascinating all the way through was to see Ted Bundy not in one role as a defendant, but in three roles. He took the stand. He testified during some of the pretrial motions. He did not take the stand during the trial itself when the jury was present, but he did take the stand. He served as a defense witness. He served as a defendant, and he ran his own defense to a large degree. He served as a defense lawyer, three roles. We've said many times that he's a former University of Utah law student, and we say that to explain why he's taking such an active role in this case and his previous cases. He has 1 year of formal classroom training in the law. He has had a lot of on-the-job sort of training, you might say, in his kidnapping case in Utah, his murder case in Colorado, and the Florida case. So he has quite a bit of poise in the courtroom, and he showed that several times. He argued the Utah evidence motion. He had made a motion to exclude evidence that was gathered against him in Utah, to have that excluded from his Florida case. He asked the questions. He testified in his own defense. He presented the legal arguments to the judge. This was a very crucial motion for the defense, and he won that motion. He showed a lot of poise as a lawyer in court. One fascinating Bundy decision came just yesterday during the sentencing phase of this trial. He decided not to let the jury hear about a psychiatric examination that was given to him much earlier in Tallahassee. During the sentencing phase, the defense can present mitigating circumstances to the jury, that is, circumstances that should sway them against the death penalty in favor of mercy and a life sentence. He could have presented psychiatric testimony that would have shown he had a mental illness, that he was a psychopath, that he had a mental illness, and that might have swayed the jury into mercy, but he chose not to have that evidence presented to the jury. That's a fascinating little aside in this trial.
I agree with you. That's something that's fascinated me very much about this trial, too, Ted Bundy's conduct in the courtroom, acting on his own behalf. And I think another aspect of this, too, that has fascinated me throughout the trial has been Bundy's relationship with the judge, or the judges in this case. You may remember, first of all, there was Judge John Rudd. He was the judge in Tallahassee, Florida, who heard most of the pretrial proceedings. Well, Ted Bundy made a motion saying that Judge John Rudd had an intense dislike for him, Bundy, and that he should be removed from the case. Surprisingly enough, Judge Rudd agreed. So Rudd was removed from the case, and it went to the Florida Supreme Court to pick a judge to hear the Ted Bundy murder trial. Well, the Florida Supreme Court turned to a man who was the chief circuit judge for the Circuit Court of Miami, Judge Edward Cowart. Now, Judge Cowart was in charge of about 50 other judges on this circuit court, and he was also doing all the administrative work for this entire court. A very strong-minded judge, and one very highly thought of. Judge Cowart took over the rest of the trial. And there was very many interesting moments, especially when Bundy was attempting to defend himself. and presenting motions to Judge Coward himself. There was the time, I think about 2 weeks into the trial, and Allison, you were covering it at this time, when Ted Bundy was complaining about jail conditions. And as he was making his point, he was pointing his finger at the judge. Well, this seemed to anger Judge Coward, and he said, "Don't point your finger at me, young man," in that southern drawl, but you know that he meant what he said at that time. But then there were some very contradictory actions on the judge as far as his relationship with Bundy goes. There was also times when Bundy was attempting to defend himself, and he was standing there acting as his own lawyer, and prosecution making arguments at the time, and Judge Cowart would intercede and place objections for Ted Bundy because Bundy had missed obvious points that he should have made objections on. In other words, this judge was looking out for Ted Bundy in a way. Judge Edward Cowart, a former motorcycle cop from Miami with this interesting relationship with a man charged with brutal murders. But I think most of all, in the moment that maybe raised some goosebumps on me, was this afternoon. And it came at the very close of the trial, when Judge Coward was recessing the court. Bundy asked for one last favor. It was granted, but not without some fatherly words for the man who had just moments earlier sentenced Bundy to die.
This court will be in recess and adjourned within this bill.
Your Honor. Everybody remain seated.
Hold on just remain a minute, seated. Mr. Bundy.
The earlier request that I made concerning...
We'll grant you. We'll
is there some way my family request. Can get out of here before the news media get on them?
Can we escort them out the back way? Right, we'll take care of it. I'll get them to see you this afternoon.
Thank you.
Everybody take care of yourself, seated. Young man.
Thank you.
I say that to you sincerely. Take care of yourself. It's a tragedy for this court to see it's such a total waste, I think, of humanity that I've experienced in this court. You're a bright young man. You made a good lawyer. I'd love to have you practice in front of me, but you went another way, partner. Take care of yourself. I don't have any animosity to you. I want you to know that.
Same.
Take care of yourself.
Thank you.
Court of entry, sir.
Remain seated, please, so the judge is out of the courtroom.
Watch y'all.
Newswatch 2 is a presentation of KUTV, recognized as the leader in broadcast journalism.
Aboard the Concorde, one of these people has uncovered an international conspiracy.
I have the documents, Captain.
Now the lives of over 100 other passengers are threatened.
He fired one!
And even at twice the speed of sound, can the Concorde evade attack? The Concorde, Airport 79, rated PG.
Starts Friday at the Century Theaters, Elks Twin Cinemas, Redwood Drive-In, Riverdale Plaza in Ogden, and Carillon Square in Provo.